Welcome to the village.
Creative and Active is back this week. We are going to start with Creative, and it's going to be Thursday at 6:30 p.m. on Zoom and on Google Classroom. So Google Classroom's a bit of an extra one for this term. We're going to put up some assignments and some fun quizzes and things, YouTube clips, things that you can link to if you are interested. So if you can't make the Zoom on a Thursday evening, you could still be part of Creative and Active by going on Google Classroom. If you want some extra stuff to do, then you've got that as well. I'm just showing you on screen now. It's so easy. You just have to have a Google account. Then you sign in using the code. You can look up through either the stream or the classwork. You click on there and you can see Jesus Calms the Storm. I've put in a YouTube clip that you can link to a video and also a Bible verse. But there is more stuff that's going to go up there as time goes on. Look forward to seeing you Thursday night, 6:30 for Creative. The Zoom link will be sent to your parents by email or by WhatsApp. So look out for it and see you then.
Today, we have got a Bible quiz with Buddy and Joy, hashtag jokes, worship with Esther, Elisha and Abigail's gospel show, and Buddy and Joy's work out the word. We're going to start though with our worship time. Are you ready? Lights, camera, action!
What shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. But seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Each day has enough trouble of its own. So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. But seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, and all these things will be
trouble of its own.
Each day has enough trouble of its own. Do not worry, for tomorrow will worry about its own. Do not worry, for tomorrow will worry about its own. Do not worry, for tomorrow we'll worry about itself.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Buddy and Joy's Bible Quiz. First question is, what other name was the Apostle Paul called? The answer is Saul. How many books have the name John in the Bible? The answer is 4. Who was exiled to an island? The answer is John. Who shared the gospel with an Ethiopian official on the road to Gaza? The answer is Philip. Who was Peter rescued from prison by? The answer is an angel. Who went with Paul on his early mission trips? The answer is Barnabas. In what city were Jesus' followers first called Christians? The answer is Antioch. Peter prayed for a woman and she was raised from the dead. Who was she? The answer is Dorcas. Which disciple denied Jesus 3 times? The answer is Peter. What did Jesus for his disciples do at the Last Supper? The answer is wash their feet. Well done, everyone.
Engaged. Hi, my name is Hans. Sanitize your hands. Finn has been replaced by Order of the Secret Service this week. I'm here to bring you the funny of the week on a need-to-know basis. And you need to know. Why is it called the Secret Service if everyone knows about it? This message will destruct in 5 seconds. You need to find somewhere to sleep tonight. Anywhere is good, as long as it's under duvet cover. Mm-hmm. Well, that's over. Let's go on with Funny of the Week. Wait a minute. That's an arachnid in disguise. It must be a spider. Too late. It's Froggy Frog World. That guy's James Pond. What's the secret message? Funny? Shh.
And welcome to Worship with Esther. Today, I'm going to be playing All to Jesus I Surrender All on keyboard. Sing along with me.
All of us in the village, we sponsor a little girl from Ethiopia. She is 5 years old and we sponsor her through Compassion. For 92 pence a day, she can receive the chance to go to school, medical checkups and nutritional support, vocational training to go into a job, the opportunity to be nurtured by a local church, and the letters that we send will be translated into her language and she'll write back to us. We can do this together. If everybody gives £1 a month, we'll easily cover all the sponsorship costs. During the COVID-19 pandemic, some of the projects have had to close down, but the money that we send is being redirected to provide food and hygiene products for those sponsored children, their families and their local community.
Welcome back to another episode on Lighting Abigail's Gospel Show. As we continue to see how valuable we are to our God, today we need to be thankful to our God, because our God has given us everything. And most important of all, our God has given us all of his love. Our God's love is so indescribable.
In John chapter 3 verse 16, it says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life."
Amen. And in verse 17, it continues to say this: "For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him." Amen. On that note, we'll like to minister into a song speaking of God's endless love towards us. Amen.
Amen.
Important. Thank you for watching another episode on Elijah and Abigail's Gospel Show. Please subscribe and remember,
trust in the Lord. Bye!
Buddy and Joy know it's really important to stay healthy and active. But not just their bodies, also their minds. They're in training to work out the word.
Hello, everyone.
According to the Bible, what is the punishment for sin?
Death.
Excellent. And what does it mean to say Jesus defends us before God?
He took the punishment.
That we deserved, isn't it?
That we deserve.
Yeah. Do we need to perfectly follow God's rules to show him we love him?
No.
Yeah. And according to John, what does it mean if we don't even try?
It means he doesn't really love God.
Okay. So listen to this question and tell me what you think. When you think about what Jesus did for us so that we can live forever with God, how does it make you feel?
Good, happy, Googly. Good for life. Enjoying life.
Oh, that's wonderful. Thank you so much.
Goodbye. I will see you later in the morning. It'll be nice, sunny, and I will say hello. Good morning, Summer.
Everybody, let's take a look. Near the end of the Bible is a really little book, but it's got a lot of stuff that we can learn. So come on, everybody, it's time to turn to the letter we call 1 John.
Hey, we're back again, going through the book of 1 John, a letter written by the Apostle John that is all about what?
True teaching, true living, and true story I heard the other day I gotta tell you about. You see, there was this turtle
Wait,
who...
No! True teaching, true living, and true loving.
Isn't that what I said?
Well, you got the first two parts.
Right. The true teaching is the gospel, the good news about Jesus, that because of what Jesus did, we can be with God.
Yep. And the true living is following God's commands. But I don't know exactly what those are yet. What if they're hard? What if there's too many to remember?
I can't even remember what I had for lunch today. Was it a salad? No, but it was green, kinda leafy.
That's a good point.
About my lunch?
No, about God's commands. The ancient Israelites in the Old Testament had lots of laws they needed to remember. In fact, by the time of Jesus, teachers who were helping people follow God had come up with a list of 900 different rules, and they had to follow all of them.
That's the craziest thing I ever heard.
No way I could remember that many rules.
And some of those rules sound very strange to us today. The Israelites weren't allowed to eat pork.
No bacon?
No bacon. Men weren't allowed to trim their beards. Ever.
You can't shave.
Turtles aren't much for facial hair. Except for my cousin with the sideburns.
You had to sew tassels onto the corners of your coat.
Seriously? Tassels on my coat?
There's no way I could do all that. That's too many rules.
Hold on. Can you read 1 John chapter 2, verses 7 and 8?
Okay. My dear friends, I am not writing a new command to you. It is the same command you have had since the beginning. It is the teaching you have already heard. But I am writing a new command to you. This command is true. You can see its truth in Jesus and in yourselves. The darkness is passing away, and the true light is already shining.
I'm not writing a new command. I am writing a new command. Sounds like John is a little confused.
No, he's not confused. He's saying, in the olden days, you had a command, a very simple command from God, and Jesus has brought this simple command back again. Maybe it got lost in all those hundreds of rules, but Jesus says it's actually the command that really matters.
The beard trimming thing?
Nope. Love. Read verses 9 to 11.
Someone says, I am in the light. But if he hates his brother, he is still in the darkness. Whoever loves his brother lives in the light, and there is nothing in him that will cause him to do wrong. But whoever hates his brother is in darkness. He lives in darkness and does not know where he is going. The darkness has made him blind. It's all about love?
Someone once asked Jesus, of all the Old Testament rules, which one is the most important? And Jesus said, love God and love your neighbor. That's what is important to God.
So the beard trimming and the tassel sewing and the pork not eating, those don't matter anymore?
All those rules about what to wear and what to eat were given so the Israelites would know they were different from the other nations around them, that they were really set apart for God. That's what the word holy means, set apart. But followers of Jesus aren't the Israelites, we're the church. And Jesus and John say that what matters for the church is so simple, you can sum it up in one sentence. Love God and love your neighbor.
So if I don't love my neighbor or my brother or my sister, it means I'm still in the darkness? That I don't know God?
Well, we can all forget and lose our tempers or be unkind every now and then. That's not what John is talking about. But if mean is what we usually are, if unkindness is a habit of ours, it might be a sign that we haven't really met God and let him change our heart. A heart that has been changed by God has a hard time being mean.
Wow. I know a few people who need their hearts changed by God.
Not so fast, Sam. We all need our hearts changed by God.
Yeah, I guess you're right.
The darkness is passing away, and the true light is already shining. What does that mean? What's the true light?
Oh, good question. But the true light isn't a what, it's a who.
A who? A who?
The light is a person. John?
Nope, not John. Someone in the Bible said, I am the light of the world. Do you know who said that?
Jesus?
That's right. Jesus is the light. The darkness is passing away. Before Jesus came, people couldn't see God clearly. They couldn't be with him.
They were all stumbling around in the parking lot of darkness.
Exactly. But Jesus shows us God because Jesus is God. So Jesus is like a bright light that chases all the dark away. The darkness is passing away and the true light is shining. John is saying, Jesus has come. The light is here. We can see God and we can be with him.
That's really incredibly extraordinary.
The darkness is passing away. The true light is shining. It's like a movie where everything is terrible and the bad guy is winning, and then suddenly as the sun rises, a hero rides in on his white horse and everything turns around. Everything changes.
That's exactly what happened when Jesus came. The true light was here, the Son of God rose, and everything changed. Pretty cool, huh?
What a brilliant episode. Now Buddy and Joy have some questions.
John says he's writing a new command that is also a very old command. What is it? Why were the Israelites given so many rules about what to eat and what to wear? What does the word holy mean? Who called himself the light of the world?
I know you guys are smart and know all the answers to those questions, but if you want to be part of the online Work Out the Word crew, then please send me a video of yourself answering these questions, and it could be you next week.
It is almost time to say goodbye from another episode of The Village. What I just love about The Village is that you guys are involved. We are a community. And although we're online at the moment, we're still The Village. So if you guys have got ideas, perhaps you want to film your very own feature, or you just have some brilliant quiz questions, then get in touch. You can get in touch on this email address, and that is the same email address you use to join our competition. If you know where Buddy and Joy are hiding this week, they're not hiding here, they're just right next to me. But where they're hiding in our city, then get in touch. I will bring you a prize round to your doorstep and say hi if you are a winner. So don't forget to enter the competition. Let's see where Buddy and Joy have been hiding this week.
Thank you to the amazing team that put together The Village Live every week. If you want to get involved, let me know.
Praise the Lord, church. Psalm 122, verse 1 says, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Are you glad this morning that you are in the presence of the Father? Are you glad this morning for all that He's done for you? So that we are going to worship Him, we are going to dance, jump, clap, and say hallelujah to His name. The Lord has done so much for us. His mercies endures forever. His faithfulness are new every day. He is a great God in our lives. Let's take John chapter 3 verse 16 to see what the Lord has done for us. The God's gift of salvation that He's given to us. It says, and I read, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him shall not perish, but have eternal life. God's gift is so great. He loved the world so much that He gave His Son. When the world was yet sinners, His Son died for us. He sent His Son. He gave this precious gift. Imagine you having only one child, and then you are giving your child away. It's so painful, but God loves you so much. He didn't wait for you, the fallen world, to come back to Him before giving you His love. He gave His love, the most precious love in all ages that the Lord gave to us, that we will have eternal life through Him. This is so wonderful. The greatest gift, His only begotten Son, to give us a divine possession that is going into eternity. Oh, this is so great. To the mightiest motive of doing this, it's so great. God's love is so great. We can't understand it. We have to thank Him. We need to thank Him. Let's join together with His Spirit and say hallelujah. Let's join together with His Spirit and praise Him. Thank Him, bow before Him, and tell Him how much we appreciate what He's done for us. Hallelujah. Lord, we bless You. Lord, we thank You. Lord, we say hallelujah to Your name. For what You've done for us is so great. We are giving You thanks with a grateful heart, Lord. Take us in. We thank You for Your love. We thank You for all that You've done for us. You gave us Your Son because You so, so, so love us. Thank You, for in Jesus' name we've prayed. Come on, church. Let's thank Him. Let's jump, let's dance, let's clap and say, hallelujah, Lord. We bless You, Lord. Amen.
In the kingdom of light, in the kingdom of light, forever under Your dominion. You're the King of my life, You're the King of my life. You reign above it all, You reign above it all. Over the universe, and over every heart, there is no higher name. Jesus, You reign above it all. And on the cross, the work was finished. God, You poured out Your life just to give us new life. Now from the lips of the forgiven, hear the anthem arise.
in the darkness running out of an empty grave. Now seated alone in glory, enthroned on the highest praise. You sent the darkness running out of an empty grave. Now seated alone in glory, enthroned on the highest praise. You sent the darkness running out of an empty grave. Now seated alone in glory, enthroned on the highest praise. You sent the darkness running.
I love declaring that there's so much truth in that song, and I think it's an important truth that we need to be reminded of right now with all that we've been going through. Because our God, our faithful God, reigns above every circumstance and every situation. Whatever you might be going through, the name of Jesus is greater than whatever that could be. And I love the way that the prophet Isaiah put it in Isaiah 41 in verse 10. And this is God speaking really directly to us today, but it was to the children of Israel back then. But you receive this word today. Don't be afraid, for I am with you. Don't be discouraged, for I am your God. I love that. For I will strengthen you and help you. I will hold you up with my victorious right hand. I want you to be reminded of that today, that God is holding you up. You may feel weak, you may feel overwhelmed, but that word says, do not be discouraged. God wants you to be reminded that He fills you with courage today. He strengthens you and He holds you up. He shelters you and He covers you. Come on, let's worship Him. Let's honor Him for His goodness, His faithfulness in our lives.
You are the one. weapon formed against me will stand. Come on, lift it up. You hold the victory, I'm safe in your arms. No weapon formed against me will stand. Oh, we believe it. You hold the victory, I'm safe in your arms. No weapon formed against me will stand. Oh, no, no, no. 'Cause you hold the victory, I'm safe in your arms. No weapon formed against me will stand. Oh, 'cause you hold the victory, I'm safe in your arms. No weapon formed against me will stand. 'Cause you hold the victory, I'm a child of God. No weapon formed against me will stand. 'Cause you hold the victory. You hold the victory. You hold the victory. You hold the victory. Yes, you are.
Yes, church, it is time for our offering and tithes. And I'll take a test that supports what we are going to give today. It is from Proverbs chapter 3, verses 9 and 10. And I read, honor the Lord with your wealth, with the fat fruits of all your crops. Then your barns will be filled to overflowing, and your vats will brim over with new wine. Yes, when we truly give generously to our Father in heaven, He's going to reward us. He says He is the greatest provider. He's going to fill your barns. He's going to make it overflow. Don't think about what you will wear tomorrow or what. Don't think about the money you have, that this is the last bit. Just think about God, the greatest provider. Just think about, He said, tomorrow will take care of itself. So just give generously. Give from your heart and trust Him. Trust Him. The word He has spoken shall surely prevail. And your barns will be filled to overflowing, and your vats will brim over with wine. Trust these words. This is the word of God. He has spoken it, and it will surely prevail in your life if you obey. Trust Him. Thank God that today He's giving us something that we can give back to Him. Father, we thank You for Your provision. We thank You that You are God and You know our capabilities. We thank You that this morning, whatever is coming out of our pockets into Your coffers, Lord, You will bless it. So it will be fruitful for the purpose of which it is being given. We thank You that You've replenished our pockets. You've replenished with so much blessings over us, because Your word says that You will fill our barns. We thank You, Lord, for doing this in our lives. Those who couldn't even get to give, Lord, we thank You for their lives. We thank You that You bless them, and the next time they will also have and give to You. We bless You. We thank You in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Within Shore Community Church. Due to the current government restrictions, we have the following programs available for you online. We have a prayer meeting which takes place every Sunday at 9:30 to 10 a.m. on Zoom. We have the Village Live, which is interactive family Bible fun every Sunday on Church Online and YouTube. Then we have our Sunday celebration service, which takes place on YouTube and Church Online at 10:30 a.m. And if you miss out, you can catch up later on YouTube. Youth Alpha course is on every Thursday on Zoom. We have Freedom in Christ class on every Tuesday. We have the youth service on YouTube at 7 p.m. every Friday, so make sure you don't miss out. We also have two alpha courses. One will be taking place on Monday evening at 7 p.m. to 8:30 p.m. The other will take place on Wednesday morning, 10:30 a.m. to 12 p.m. Life groups will resume on the 8th of September on Zoom, WebEx and Skype. And if you are not part of a life group, there will be an invitation sent out for you to register. There is also a new life group that starts at church every Wednesday at 1 p.m. If you haven't attended one of our membership classes, please send us an email and we will arrange a membership class for you. Friday at 10 p.m. to midnight for our monthly prayer meeting. The link for the Zoom call will be sent out on the day. We've also started a Bible study with Pastor Paul on the book of Genesis, which takes place every Saturday at 7 p.m. on Zoom.
Creative and Active is back this week. We are going to start with Creative and it's going to be Thursday at 6:30 p.m. on Zoom and on Google Classroom. So Google Classroom is a bit of an extra one for this term. We're going to put up some assignments and some fun quizzes and things, YouTube clips, things that you can link to if you are interested. So if you can't make the Zoom on a Thursday evening, you could still be part of Creative and Active by going on Google Classroom. If you want some extra stuff to do, then you've got that as well. I'm just showing you on screen now. It's so easy. You just have to have a Google account. Then you sign in using the code. You can look up through either the stream or the classwork. You click on there and you can see Jesus Calms the Storm. I've put in a YouTube clip that you can link to a video and also a Bible verse. But there is more stuff that's going to go up there as time goes on. Look forward to seeing you Thursday night, 6:30 for Creative. The Zoom link will be sent to your parents by email or by WhatsApp. So look out for it and see you then.
After the church service, we have a Zoom coffee and a catch up. So bring your own brew and join in Zoom and let's see each other online.
Right guys, I am so excited about this next part. I am excited to tell you about a new feature that is coming up on, wait for it, WCC TV on a Sunday afternoon when normally we would have had our evening service, but we are going to have in partnership with Right Now Media, we're going to be showing different studies, and not only that, with time, we're going to be encouraging different people who are talented in the church to come onto WCC TV and share what God has given them, their talents and abilities that God has given them, like gardening, like cooking, like exercising, getting healthy. All these amazing things are coming to WCC TV. So what we would like you to do is to tune in on a Sunday evening, 5 o'clock till 7 p.m. And please make sure you like, subscribe and share, and also comment below to give us any thoughts, any ideas that you might have. And then we will put this all together and let's all share as a community what God has for us. I'm excited. I hope you are. See you there. Bye.
church family. We are now having church every Sunday. If you would like to join us on Sundays, wear your face mask, keep your social distance, but come into the presence of God. Let me know. I'll book you in. I'll book your own seat for you and your family if you want your family to come. But first, let me know, and then I can book you a seat.
Hi, everyone. I've been enjoying the series that we've been having recently on WCC, on Sunday services. And I just felt led to come on here and to share a little bit of my story. So some of you know that my favorite color is green, but what you probably don't know is the reason why. So when I was young and growing up, I always felt so alone. Even around loads of people, I felt isolated. I felt like I was invisible and I didn't exist, to the point that many people would share their deep secrets around me, not because they intended to, but it's just because they didn't see me. I didn't exist. And as I kept growing up and seeing all these things around me, I kind of felt like the world was really cruel. And I got to a point where I felt like, you know what? I don't want to be here. So I made a plan. I was going to kill myself. I wrote a letter saying my goodbyes to this cruel world. And I knew exactly what I was going to do. But before that, my father had bought me a book, Bible Stories for Children. And as I read that book, I came across a God, a man called Jesus. And I started to talk to him about how I was feeling. I didn't know where these thoughts and these feelings were coming from. And I was really struggling. So I would talk to him, God, if you're really there, if you really exist, do you really exist? Do you see me? So I believe that on that day when I decided that I would take my own life, and I had the perfect plan, and I know it would have worked, that God heard that prayer of a young child, of a young girl who was desperate to be seen, desperate to be heard. And he heard my cry, my inner cry, and my sister didn't go to sleep that day as she would have done. She found my letter, and I remember her shouting at me and saying, how would everyone feel if you were not here? Now, I was surprised because I thought nobody cared. I truly believed that no one cared. It might not have been the reality, because I know that my family loved me. Now I know that. But in that moment, in those moments, any negative word was just building upon, it was like brick upon brick, a wall being built, that I would feel like I was unworthy, I wasn't loved. And God began to speak to me and tell me that I was beautiful, that I was worthy, that I was the apple of his eye. And whenever I said, but God, I'm so different from people, how can you love me? He would tell me, you know what? You are fearfully and wonderfully made, made in my image, unique. So now, when I look in the mirror and see all the things about me, all the flaws that I don't like, and I hear that voice again speak to me and say, who do you think you are? You are so unworthy. Nobody would love you. And that rejection come back to me. I remember what I read, what I saw in the mirror of God's word. And I look back and say, my name is Belinda Rosario, and I am the one whom the Lord loves. So I don't know where you are right now. You might be feeling helpless. You might be feeling discouraged. But I want to tell you that there is a God who hears your voice. Your voice, you are unique and you are loved. And he, the same way that he reached out to me and pulled me out of my darkness, he is willing and he's able to pull you out of the deep, dark place where you are right now. All you have to do is ask. You are loved. And God created you for a plan and a purpose. So what does green mean? Green means life. He said, the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but I came that you might have life and life more abundantly. And so now I live life to the fullest because God gave his life for me. And the only thing I can do is to live life how he purposed me to live it. God bless you, and I hope you have a wonderful day. If you need to speak to someone, please reach out. You can also contact WCC. There will be a message that will come up online to show you how you can get in touch and speak to someone. God is waiting on you. Speak up. Don't be silent. God bless you.
If there are over 7 billion people on Earth, then why do I feel so alone? If there is someone for everyone, then why does it feel like it's just me? If I have friends, then how come I can end up feeling so friendless? If I have family, then why do I sometimes feel like a family of one? These are some of the questions that I've had to ask myself at times, but I have never seemed to get an answer until I look into the Word of God. The truth is, if you know Jesus, you are not alone. You are not alone. No matter how many times you have walked by yourself, God says that He will be with you wherever you go. No matter how many times you have fallen and had to pick yourself up, Jesus says that He knows you and that He laid down His life for you. You are not alone. No matter how hard things have gotten, the Bible says that nothing can separate us from the love of Christ. You are not alone. No matter how long you've been waiting, Jesus says that He is coming back, and until then He has sent His Holy Spirit to live in you. You are not alone. No matter what your situation has turned into, Jesus promises that you can find rest in Him. You are not alone. No matter who has deserted you, Jesus says that He will be with you always. You are not alone. But the Bible does show us what loneliness is like. Utter loneliness is what Jesus experienced as He hung on the cross. Loneliness, sin, death, and separation are what He overcame, so that we could be with God, so that when we repent and turn to Him, we can rest in His presence, so that we can experience His friendship forever.
Good morning. Thank you for joining us this morning. Over the last couple of weeks, we have been looking at discovering our true value in God. We have seen how when God breathed the breath of life into man, He imparted part of Himself into us. And the scripture tells us in James chapter 4, verse 5, He jealously longs for the spirit that He has caused to dwell in us. This is so beautiful. God jealously desires the spirit that He has caused to dwell in us. We saw in the first message that when God breathed Himself into the man, He established a love relationship that He has never been willing to cancel. You see, in spite of all the evil that we have done, in spite of all the tragedies and disasters, in spite of all the sin, God still jealously desires the spirit that He has caused to dwell in us. This is an amazing example of God's love, that He's willing to be jealous for the people like you and me. John 3:16 tells us how, for God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Now, last week we looked at how if you really want to discover ourselves, we need to look into the mirror of God's Word to discover our inner nature. Let me just do a quick summary before we get to the message this morning, and I will try and finalize our series this morning. You know, God said, "Let us make human beings in our image." Now, God is revealed as Father, Son, and the Spirit. You see, there are three persons, but one God, and this is important, one God. In the same way, He revealed us as spirit, soul, and body, three elements, but we have one personality. You see, we are a triune being, and we are created in the likeness of a triune God. And when we look at it last week, we saw as a result of sin, there has been this malfunction in the area of our personality. But how many know that our God is gracious? He is merciful. And God has made provision for man's restoration in every area of our being. God has a plan for each area of the restored human personality, for the spirit, for the soul, and even for the body. And we saw last week how the main function of the spirit is really directly related to God. And we looked at three things. It's to worship, it's to fellowship, and revelation. Where on the other hand, three functions of the soul are self-centered. And they are mind, will, and emotions. And when we looked at the function of a restored body, is really to be a temple of God, the dwelling place of God, the Holy Spirit. And you see, when the Holy Spirit lives in the temple, we are then required to present our members to the Lord as a slave or as an instrument of God's purposes. Now the body is surrendered to the Holy Spirit. It becomes sanctified, or in simple terms, it becomes holy and set apart to God. And it's so amazing when we look into God's mirror and realize how God has formed us inside, how He's designed us in His image, in His likeness, and He restored our spirit, soul, and body to fulfill His purposes for us. And I want to tell you this morning, no matter how far we may seem, we must remember that God has never given up on the breath that He breathed into the body of man. And God, in His amazing grace, in His mercy, sent Jesus to bring us back to Him. Scripture says that Jesus came to seek and save that which was lost and cut off. And that is why He came. He came for the descendants of Adam. He came for you and me. That is how much He loves us. Do you know what Jesus' favorite title, which appears more than 80 times in the gospel, is? It's the Son of Man. You see, He was the son of David. He was the son of Abraham. But He called Himself the Son of Man, the son of Adam, the representative of the Adamic race. Now here's an amazing truth. In 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5, it says, "For there is one God, one mediator between God and mankind, the man Christ Jesus." Now this was written many years after death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. It reveals that a man sits on the throne of God, the man Christ Jesus. That is a breathtaking thought if you can grasp it. A representative of our race has taken a seat at the highest place in the universe. A man, Christ Jesus, is on the throne of God. That is how valuable we are in the sight of God. As I bring our series to an end, I want us to look at a few verses in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 13. Now, chapter 13 is truly a rich and exciting chapter. It has seven parables. And as I conclude our series, I want us to look at two of the shortest parables. One of these is just one verse and the other two verses. Now, they are short parables, but they are packed with truths about our identity. And I want you to think about your identity as I read and as I expand on these two parables, okay? Now, my Bible gives the heading for the first one as the parable of the hidden treasure. Jesus is speaking in Matthew chapter 13, verse 44, and this is what He said. "The kingdom of heaven is like this. A man happens to find a treasure hidden in the field. He covers it up and is so happy that he goes and sells everything he has and then goes back and buys the field. As you might already know, I'm originally from Middle East. Jesus was also from Middle East. So let me expand on this parable, and we're going to look at it from a Middle Eastern lens. I want you to picture a rich man, and this man is wealthy. I mean, he's loaded. Sadly, there is a war, and we have many of that in the Middle East. Now I want you to picture an army, and this army is marching. They're killing and destroying every property that they come along. Now this rich man knows that the army is approaching him. Remember, in those days there were no banking system. He was afraid of losing all his hard work possessions. So he went quickly into the field and buried his treasure. I mean, everything that was valuable to him, he buried it under the ground. You see, the man escaped the war, but he did not manage to get back to collect his possession. Now, years later, the land is repossessed and now is owned by someone else. Now, the man that owns the land doesn't really know about the hidden treasure. Now, this man owns a lot of land, so it's just another land to him. Sometime later, another man comes along and finds the hidden treasure. This man quickly hides it and covers it up, and he just wants to make sure that no one else sees it. You know, he knows if he would tell anyone that the owner might find it and that he might lose everything. What does he do? He goes back home. He sells everything that he has. Think about it. He sells everything that he has, and he comes back to the owner. And he says, you know what? I want to buy your land. And I want to, and he puts this offer that he couldn't refuse. Now, imagine the people in the village. I mean, they're all like shocked. I mean, why would he buy a field? There's nothing on that field. There's worth nothing. You see, but once he buys the field, once he got the field and he digs up the treasure, you see, and when people really see what was underneath that field, they finally understand why he bought the land. Now, I know there are many ways of interpreting parables, but I would like to give you the way I interpret this. And I want to say to you, the man who bought the field is Jesus. The field is the world. You see, Jesus died for the whole world. He paid the price for the whole world. But it's not the world that he wants. It's the treasure in the field. Now you might be asking yourself, well, what is the treasure? You see, the treasure is God's people. Jesus was willing to pay the price for apparently a worthless field in order to get to the treasure. Yes, in order to get to you, in order to get to me. And that's how much he cares for us. And that's how much he thinks of us. And that's how much we mean to him. We are not unimportant. We are not insignificant to him. We are not worthless to him. I want to tell you that we are extremely valuable to God. We are so valuable that Jesus gave his life to purchase us. You see, never again should you think about yourself as unimportant or insignificant or worthless. Just get rid of all that kind of thinking. It's not scriptural. It's definitely not in the Bible. Now listen, I'm not telling you that you may be prideful, but I'm telling you to realize your true value. You gain nothing by an attitude of bringing yourself down. That's not pleasing to God. You are a son of God. You are of a daughter of God. Listen to me. God doesn't have second-class children. You are important to him. You are very, very valuable to him. You are so, so special to him. The whole point of this series is to show you your true value. You need to let go of any sense of worthlessness. You do not have to apologize for being you. It's you that God wants. He wants you the way you are. But remember that you are not glorifying God if you're trying to be humble. That's not humility. That's actually unbelief. Right now, if you have received Christ Jesus by faith, you are a child of God. You are part of his beautiful treasure. You are so valuable to him. Like I already said, when I look at this parable, I believe that the man who bought the field is Jesus. The field is the world, and I see the ministry of gospel as the digging out the treasure. You see, Jesus bought the field, but he leaves it to us to dig up the treasure. And you know that when treasure has been underneath the ground for a long time, it is often stained, it's blemished, and it's dirty. And that's part of the ministry, to polish it up and clean it up. And as a minister of God, it's my role to polish the treasure that has been under the ground for so long. As a pastor, God has given me a sense of value of God's people. You see, our mission in our church is to be a church that provides a place of refuge and restoration for all, and to be a place where all our members are inspired to connect, to grow, to use their God-given potential. You see, but it's when you invest your time in reading your Bible, it's when you invest your time in praying, it's when you invest your time in connect with other Christians, it's when you invest your time and join a life group, joining a Bible study, that's when you realize, that's when you discover that you have potential, that you have a purpose in life, that there is a reason why you are here. That you are that treasure. You are that treasure that Jesus paid for, that you are valuable to him. But you have to invest time. You have to discover your true value. You see, when you discover your true value, then as part of the gospel is to make Jesus known in your sphere of influence. But you can only do that successfully when you discover your true value in God's eyes. When you discover your identity, your purpose, and that is when your life will be transformed. That is when your life will be changed. And that is when people will discover a new you. And that's when they want to know, well, why are you so different? And that's when we share the good news and we make Jesus known in our sphere of influence. Now let us look at the second parable. And this parable is found straight after verse 44, and it's verses 45 to 46, and it reads this. And again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant looking for fine pearls. When he found one of the great value, he went away and sold everything he had and bought it. Again, there is so many ways of looking at this parable. I want to give you my interpretation. First thing I want to point out here is, I want to point out that the man in this parable was a merchant. He wasn't a tourist. He wasn't on the beach and then suddenly found a pearl. This guy was a merchant. He was a man who spent his life dealing with pearls. So when he saw the pearl, he knew the real value of that pearl. When he found this one pearl, he fell in love with it. He felt so much in love with it that he sold all that he had to buy it. Now, I want you to think about it this way. Imagine now the man going home to his wife and saying, "Hi, baby, how are you doing? By the way, I sold our car today." Now, can you imagine the response? "You what? You sold our car? Why did you do that?" Now, imagine now the man trying to explain how he found this one pearl. Imagine the shock. The wife will be like, "What? A pearl? One pearl? Well, thank God at least we have a roof over our heads." Now imagine when he turns around and says, "Well, I sold the house too." You see, this was a man who knew what things were worth. He found one pearl and he was worth more than everything he had. He literally sold everything he had to buy this one pearl. Now, I want you to think for a moment. Think of yourself as being that one pearl, that beautiful, that valuable pearl. I don't know if you know this, but pearls are formed as a result of process of suffering. Out of the irritation caused to an oyster by one grain of sand, a pearl is made. Now, maybe you have been through suffering. Maybe your life has not been great. Maybe you have seen things, you have experienced things that no one should have experienced. Now, as a result, you are now questioning whether God really loves you. Maybe you started to think that you are not worth much to God. Maybe you think that you are not important to God. that there are other people that are more important to God, but not you. I want to tell you that is not true at all. That is not true at all. You are important to God. You are so important to God that God gave His Son, Jesus, to die on that cross for you. Yes, for you, especially for you. Jesus sold all that He had. He left all the riches of the glory in heaven, became a carpenter's son, became a traveling preacher. When He died on the cross, He literally owned nothing. He was buried in a borrowed linen cloth, in a borrowed tomb. And that is how the Apostle Paul puts it in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though He was rich, yet for your sake He became poor, so that you, through His poverty, might become rich. You see, Jesus sold all that He had. He gave up everything for you. He not only purchased the treasure in the field, He also purchased the one pearl with everything that He had. And that pearl is you. Yes, you. You watching this program. Yes, you in your weaknesses. Yes, you with all your failures. Yes, you with your lack of understanding, with all your frustrations, with all the fears and your anxiety. Jesus died for you. And I really believe, I'm 100% convinced that if no one else would ever have been saved, that Jesus would have died for me. That if I was the only person left on this earth, that Jesus would have still given up His life for me. You see, I like to make His love personal. I like to say, for me He died. For me He gave up His throne. For me He laid down His life. For me He suffered on the cross and He was buried. And then for me He rose. He ascended and He is at the Father's right hand. Now, if you have a problem with self-worth, if you have a low sense of self-esteem, if you do not really feel that you matter to God or even to others, this is the truth for you. You may be lonely. You may be wondering how you ever got here. You're watching this service online. And I want to tell you, God brought you to this point. I want to tell you, honestly, I believe that God brought you to this point, that you have an appointment with God right now. Think of yourself this way. Think of a merchant who bought this pearl and he's holding you in the palm of his hand. He's looking down at you and he's saying this. He's saying, you are so beautiful. You are the most beautiful thing that I've ever seen. You cost me everything that I had. But you know what? You are worth it. You are so beautiful. You are so precious. Now, I want you to realize that you are that pearl. You are that pearl. You are in the palm of our Lord Jesus Christ. And He's looking at you. And He's saying that you are beautiful. You cost me everything that I had. But I love you because I am glad that I died for you. You are beautiful, and I am so glad that I died for you. So as I'm finishing this series, I want to help you. If you're experiencing low self-esteem, if you're experiencing a sense of low value, I want to suggest that you take this step and you pray this prayer after me. If you have a problem with self-esteem, now don't be afraid. Don't be ashamed. Don't look around and say, I don't feel comfortable praying this. Just pray this prayer after me right now. I want you to think about yourself as in this expensive pearl. Just close your eyes for a second, okay? Just close your eyes for a second. And just imagine yourself as one of the pearl in the hand of our Lord Jesus Christ. Can you see the scars in His hand? Can you see the scars of suffering for you? And I want you to listen as Jesus is speaking to you. He's saying, you are beautiful, that you cost me all that I had, but you are worth it. I am glad I gave my life for you. Now, as you still have those pictures in your mind, just pray this prayer after me, okay? Lord Jesus, I thank you that you died for me. that you gave yourself on that cross, a debt of agony and shame to purchase me. And Lord, I belong to you. I am yours forever. I know you will never leave me. You will never forsake me. I'm in the palm of your hand. I am beautiful in your eyes. More beautiful than the worlds you created, because you set your love on me. And because you love me, Lord, I love you. Receive my love as I give it to you now. I give myself afresh to you right now, Lord. I thank you that I'm not unwanted. I thank you that I'm not unworthy. I thank you that I'm not a cast off. I thank you that I'm not rejected. I am accepted and loved by you. Lord Jesus, I accept you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you again and again. Thank you for the wonderful love that you poured out on the cross. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen and amen. Now, if you pray that prayer, I want to ask you to take one more step. For the next couple of weeks, every day that you wake up in the morning, why don't you look at yourself in the mirror? Why don't you just say these words after yourself? I'm not rejected. I'm not unwanted. I am precious to the Lord. Will you do that for me? Let me just say that again. I'm not rejected. I'm not unwanted. I am precious to the Lord. Now, one more thing before we close our service. We want to pray a prayer that the Apostle Paul prayed in 1 Thessalonians 5:23. We want to pray a prayer of sanctification. Sanctify means simply to make holy. In this prayer, we're going to be praying to ask God to make us holy. And we're going to personalize the Apostle Paul's prayer. Okay, just pray this prayer after me. And may the God of peace make me holy in every way. And may my whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless until our Lord Jesus Christ comes again. In Jesus' precious name I pray. Amen and amen. Now, if you prayed both of those prayers, you have not just acknowledged God's acceptance, but you have also asked Him to prepare your spirit, soul, and body to be completely His. And that is a prayer that He will always answer. Amen. Remember, whenever you see yourself in the mirror for the next couple of days, just say, I am not rejected. I am not unwanted. I am precious to the Lord. I trust that this series has been helpful in making you see your true value. I pray that you may grow daily in the knowledge and the joy of how much you actually matter to God. I want to thank you again. I want to thank you again for joining us this morning. God bless you.
Thank you for tuning in this morning. Don't forget to like and subscribe, and also share this video on to someone who you know will be encouraged by it. We're having tea and coffee on Zoom and a chat and fellowshipping together. Please join us if you can. God bless you all. See you next week. My